Welcome, welcome everybody. Good evening. Friday, 6 p.m. in California, 9 p.m. on the East Coast, where we have beautiful composers joining us as well this evening, Christopher J. Ho and Joshua Fishbein from the Mid-Atlantic region. Julie and I today have prepared a music and conversation with theme Americana, building on composers, living composers, Black composers, female composers. We have some requests this evening that are coming through. Starting with, it is still officially summertime, and it is over 100 degrees in California today. So on our end of the earth, it is definitely still summertime. I'm Solma Zadeli, and this is Julie Puklepski. Welcome everybody to Americana Music and Conversation on August 14th, 2020. We are here live from Julie Puklepski's beautiful living room.
Yes, and we were talking with Solmaz about how much we love to perform together, and as much as we love to perform in various places and fundraisers and all kinds of events and seeing our friends, it's still really, really special to get to do this in my living room, where one of the reasons why, I mean, I know you can't really see a whole bunch of it, you only see one little corner, that several years ago, my husband and I bought this house because it has huge vaulted ceiling and a big staircase so that we can have salon-style concerts. Mm-hmm. So for tonight, welcome to my living room from the comfort of your living room, and hopefully one day soon, we'll be able to have this actually with all of you here.
Yes. So thank you, Julie, for having us. And this is the beginning of a series of music and conversation salon style performances that she and I will do from the comforts of our home for the time being. Please, as we go forward, feel free to always email requests. The theme will be Americana, highlighting always each session, living composers. Today's performance, we're going to highlight a couple of Black composers, female composers. This next piece is called Compensation. This was written by Charles Lloyd Jr. in 1977. prolific African-American composer and professor. And this was set to a poem by Paul Laurence Dunbar. As many of you know, art songs are often set to existing poetry. This existing poem called Compensation by Paul Laurence Dunbar was written shortly after the Civil War by Paul Laurence Dunbar, who was a first generation Black American, free Black American, the son of enslaved people who were enslaved in Kentucky. They went over to Ohio where he was born, and he wrote many, many beautiful poems, this one being Compensation. The gift of song were those last words from the poem Compensation.
I love this piece. I'm so happy that you chose it, and thank you to whoever requested it. It's unbelievably gorgeous and special.
Yes. This evening, we're going to be highlighting songs, art songs, folk songs, songs that were composed by American composers. We have two living composers this evening as panelists who will join us soon, Joshua Fishbein and Christopher Jaho. This song is a special request by a very, very dear friend and doctor who's been working very, very hard the past few months, as you can imagine. Today, this evening, at home, healthy in his living room watching us. It's his birthday today, so this is a special request from him, an art song that is truly American. Black is the color of my true love's hair. I think many have heard this song, Joan Baez, lots of singers from the 60s and 70s have done arrangements of this song. This arrangement that Julie and I are doing today in fact, is what is thought to be most similarly associated with the original melody and original arrangement of this song.
I know.
Thanks, Gus. Thanks, Gus, for having your birthday today, making this request.
Because this also happens to be one of my favorite songs, and who better to perform this with than my friend with the beautiful black hair.
Dark brown hair, exactly.
Close enough. Although maybe now with COVID, it might be, you know, a mix.
Dark mix, exactly.
With some white sprinkle. You know?
As long as we have California sun, it won't get too black. Happy birthday, Gus. And thank you for all you're doing on the front lines, as he's a doctor. And we think about you every day. Stay healthy. So, another request. I'm so happy so many viewers today have put in requests. Please keep it coming as these Americana music and conversation series keeps going. This request the request was for a female composer by a dear friend of mine whose birthday is tomorrow, who is a professor emeritus of women's studies. So we chose American Lullaby by Gladys Rich. Much like my friend Dr. Mary Crawford, Gladys Rich was one of 13 siblings, I believe 9 of whom survived. And she's from Middle America, so one of a big American family, the only one of her siblings to have left her hometown and gone back east, so Middle America, gone back east and become a composer. Gladys Rich wrote this song in the 30s. This song is about a very different kind of American life than we see today. This song was written by Gladys Rich in the 1930s, about growing up in a very, quote, typical American household. This is called American Lullaby. My child certainly would not. He would sing along. I think your children as well.
I think mine would dance along.
We are, alas, no longer in the 1930s, where children fall asleep to the radio. Exactly. That was American Lullaby by Gladys Rich.
Yeah.
So the next two pieces are a song cycle by Christopher J. Ho, who's joining us live from his home in Arlington, Virginia. Thank you so much for being here, Chris. a very dear friend. Chris is a diplomat by trade, a composer by night and day now. You can find his music on HOH, homademusic.com. Chris has composed this in 2019, a song cycle of two songs, two American ballads, and I'm gonna let him take over the mic, so to speak, and tell us a little bit about your inspiration. Yeah, your inspiration behind these songs. The original arrangement being a trio for mezzo soprano and piano and cello, and how you decided on those and that instrumentation, how you came across these poems, what inspired you to, besides my Americana program, to compose these pieces.
Okay, well, hello, Solmaz, Julie, Joshua, and everybody else out there, and thank you for putting these pieces on your program. So the original motivation by a music director at George Washington Middle School for something for her chorus. And the original form of these arrangements of two American folk songs was for a middle school chorus and piano. Now that's a school in Alexandria, Virginia. And so I thought, okay, what will be kind of tied to that area and to some other things they may be learning about in school? And so I picked Virginia folk songs that could have actually been sung in that place in the time of George Washington, because it's right by where George Washington used to live. These are actually folk songs that have roots back in England and in the British Isles since before our colonial times, but then they morphed here. And I thought, okay, how can I have something that has enough contrast that the set, the pair is interesting, but has something tying them together? So they're two love songs. The first is slow, the second is fast. There's your contrast. And then, like any folk song, they have hundreds, if not thousands, of variations in words and tunes and things. So I had to kind of sort that out. I don't know, Solmaz, when you get to the second one, if you're going to sing about a glass of wine or a cooling drink. The original was glass of wine.
Glass of wine on this Friday evening.
That's
especially
great.
On the Sabbath, right? Right, Joshua? Yeah.
Well, good, because glass of wine was how Gene Ritchie, the famous Virginia folk singer, sang it, and others. But the one request I had from the middle school teacher was, can we change that? So in
so you have two arrangements.
Middle school version. Anyway, you can want, and I think maybe that's enough said, and we'll just let these, they're both great tunes with fun words, and we'll hopefully let them speak for themselves.
Yes,
it ties a little bit into what I was saying about black is the color of my true love's hair earlier, where folk songs were originally not written down, the original melodies that they the melodies that are thought to be original weren't usually written down till later on, like Chris was saying. So these, we think, were performed or sung just in the classroom during music class, perhaps during George Washington's time, just as black was the color, that folk song was perhaps performed in the 1830s or sung in people's homes just like this in the 1830s to that original melody, but we're not quite sure. And this is Christopher J. Ho's melody. Let me get the music up.
So this is the riddle.
While you're doing that, I'm just piping up because we didn't say the first one is the riddle song, which is I Gave My Love a Cherry. And the second is Shady Grove, which is both about a person sometimes named Shady Grove and about a place that's the Shady Grove. And here we use the tradition of Shady Grove as the place.
Thank you. The Riddle Song.
Oh,
We've got wine, bread, and meat in that song, not milk. Thank you so much, Chris. Beautiful. I love singing this song, or both of these. These two songs, part of a song cycle, two love songs. I debuted last year in Pebble Beach with piano and cello. This original arrangement was for trio. So Mike Dahlberg was on the cello and Ben Dorfin was on the piano. And we gave this very, very special debut to in someone's home in Pebble Beach. Hi to those of you that were at that concert that are here tonight live. I know many of you are, as well as a couple of birthday boys and girls. Good to have you here again for this in Julie's living room on a virtual concert. Next, we have another living composer who's here with us this evening, Joshua Fishbein, who's also in the Mid-Atlantic in Maryland, tuning in to be with us here today and speak a little bit about this particular song. I was introduced to Joshua, in fact, by Chris. That was really lovely. In the fall, he came to one of my performances back on the East Coast, and we got to talking, and I reached out to him recently about performing one of his pieces that was written for mezzo soprano or baritone, so low voice and piano. I picked this one today as it is the Shabbat. This beautiful piece, Adon Olam, is a Shabbat prayer. L'chaim to everyone at home who is celebrating, hopefully with some wine as well. And I'm gonna let Joshua speak a little bit about this piece. What's the inspiration aside from, of course, scripture? How did you come about deciding to set this particular prayer? I think you were in Los Angeles at the time. Tell us a little bit about where you were, what inspired you, any kind of musical expressive phrases or information that you'd like the audience to kind of listen to as Julie and I debut this piece today, about seven or 8 years later. Joshua.
Thank you, Solmaz, and thank you, Julie, for programming this piece and for preparing it. I wrote the piece, I guess it was about 8 years ago now, when I was living in LA. I was part of a group in LA called the Max Helfman Fellowship of Jewish Composers. There were a lot of composers, songwriters, several composers who wrote commercial music as well as concert music. And we would go on retreats to the Brandeis Bardeen campus of American Jewish University out in Simi Valley, which is actually the second, I believe it's the largest owned piece of Jewish land outside of the state of Israel. I could compose any Jewish piece I wanted to for this particular performance opportunity. And I chose Adon Olam because it was one of the ones I was most familiar with. We also kind of divvied up parts of the service, so no one else had chosen it. Adon Olam Adon Olam happens at the end of the Shabbat service on Saturday morning. And it's usually like a throwaway piece. It happens quickly because everyone wants to, you know, get onto the Kiddush luncheon and eat some food and drink some wine. So it's rarely a substantial composition, but I wanted to really set the words in a meaningful way. My piece is about 6 minutes long. I mean, your average Adon Olam is probably like a minute or 2 minutes maybe, because there are quite a few words. Let me quickly share the screen so you can see the words.
Wonderful.
Yes. One moment. Okay. So here are the words. There are five stanzas, which are, you can read the English down here. Usually it's set in a strophic way, meaning the music is repeated and the words change. But as you can see, the words are different for the different verses. Lord of the world who reigned before the universe was formed, when by his will all things were created, then he was proclaimed king. And it's very different from verse to verse. I chose the end as the pinnacle of the piece. The Lord is with me, I shall not fear. Adonai li velo ira. And so those are the words written by Solomon ibn Gaberol, a medieval Jewish poet and scholar from the Iberian Peninsula. A musical inspiration was, and I'll move away from the lyrics now. Musical inspiration was another song by the Argentinian Jewish composer Osvaldo Goliov, who wrote a beautiful song, Lua Descolorida. In that setting, he had a lovely refrain on just an open ah vowel. And I thought, wouldn't it be great to use the last syllable of each verse, which ends with an ah vowel, as a way to sing a refrain, even though there's not a refrain in the text. Anyway, I don't want to talk too long. I'll leave you to it.
And we'll do further talking in some more Q&A after these. We wanted to be able to have you all here and introduce the pieces and then open it up for a chat afterwards. Some people will be chatting on the Facebook chat, some people on the Zoom chat. So we'll give a moment to speak about the pieces and about all the things that we as musicians do after this prayer. Adon Olam. Thank you, Joshua, for composing this beautiful piece, Adon Olam, a Hebrew prayer for the Sabbath. Right now, we'd like to take a moment to open up the conversation a bit more, chats, dialogue, questions you might have for the composers. As musicians, we wear many hats. Christopher J. Ho is not only a composer, he was a diplomat for many, many years. I met him when we were both living in Vienna at the time. He serves now on the board for the 13, a beautiful a cappella group of singers who are based around, in and around the Mid-Atlantic area. He does a lot for his church. He's from a long line of Lutheran ministers, so a very, very strong musical foundation, and if I may say so, professional producing foundation, in that you know how the business works, you know how organizations thrive, you know how to compose. And Joshua Fishbein conducts and is a choir director as well. I'd like for you all to expand a little bit about how you built your musical life, how it developed into what you are today. Julie is a pianist, the director of operations for San Jose International Piano Competition, also has her own music school, Opus 11, based in the Bay Area. I am a mezzo-soprano, founder of Voice Academy Soul, which has different projects, teaching, giving master classes, hosting webinars like this, where we bring in music of living composers. We talk, we make this music part of our lives for the audience, not only for supporters and enjoyers of the music, but also in a way to have everyone kind of collaborate and share and know that music as a way of life is for all of us. Chris and Josh, can you expand a little bit about what else you do besides composing, your other parts of your musical life?
Sure.
Drumroll.
Unlike Chris, I don't have a non-musical day job aside from teaching, which I do a lot of. I teach at the college level. I've taught at several universities, the University of Nevada in Las Vegas, the College of New Jersey, the Peabody Conservatory, and Johns Hopkins University.
Choir too. I know some of your choir members are listening tonight.
Ah, yes.
Hi out there. Thank you for joining.
And I work as actually both a synagogue musician and a church musician. I direct an Episcopal church choir in the D.C. area, and I also work with two different synagogue choirs. I have a group called Kol Rina, based at Chizuk Emunah Congregation of Baltimore. I actually used to be based in the Bay Area, and I worked at Grace Cathedral in San Francisco, and also Church of the Advent of Christ the King. You see, what you have to understand is that in Jewish music, choral music and classical music was not as big of a thing as it is in many churches, especially the especially the Episcopal Church. Also, the Midwest Lutherans do a lot of great classical choral music. Some Catholic churches, not tons of Catholic churches anymore, do a lot of classical music. But I have to watch out what I say. I am on Facebook Live.
We're not political tonight. This is a music zone.
Music zone. That's good. So you know, I have met many jobs as an educator and music educator and a choir director for both Jewish and Christian organizations.
So that's influenced your music. Also, of course, Adon Olam. Tell us a little bit about. You heard us for the first time this evening perform this live, right? So tell us, I guess, a little bit about What was different about it from when you had heard it live before? What has changed? Maybe some nuances that were different you'd like to address and tell the audience about?
Sure. There are a couple of optional notes in the score. That's different depending on the singer. Right. Yeah, a few singers have sung this before. I also have a version of it for chorus that I arranged after the fact. It started really as a solo piece, and then I later arranged it for chorus, and it was done by the Delaware Valley Chorale in Wilmington.
So where can we find all of your music, Josh? Please let us know where to go, the audience members watching.
Oh, sure. Fishbinemusic.com.
Fishbinemusic.com. And so this score and other scores, you have a lot of choral works also on that website, correct?
That's correct. That's on my website. And, you know, you can also find recordings on SoundCloud and YouTube. I'm on there too.
Right.
I think you did a great job of capturing the essence behind the piece, especially Velo Ira, I Shall Not Fear, very dramatic towards the end. So
it's written, that musical notation written here is warm. So I hope I did it justice. And Chris, briefly about some of your music, also choral music. You've sung in choirs for most of your life, certainly your whole adult life, I think. Tell us a little bit about your musical background as we're kind of wrapping this up with a little bit for those that are signing in now, Q&A with the composers, Joshua Fishbein, Christopher J. Ho, Julie Pokleski on the piano, also director of operations for the San Jose International Piano Competition. And I'm Soul Mazadeli, also founder of Voice Academy Soul. So we're talking a little bit about all the background stuff that musicians do, aside from being on stage
and the many hats
have to wear.
Exactly. That we all have to have.
Sure. Well, let me jump in on the many hats. And I'll say, I looked at the chat. So far, no questions. But
okay.
I think you're asking people if they have questions for us to put them there. So my hat for a day job for over 30 years was as a diplomat with the State Department. But I never stopped doing music. And I think it was about the time I could walk and played piano and accompanied lots. Got to college and concentrated on international affairs. But every place I went around the world, music was a way to connect with people, and often a way that you could connect with people outside of the official embassy world, which was a great way to get insights into the culture and just to meet people, including people who kind of knew me in another context and didn't immediately put up that, oh, he's the US government representative. So that I think was helpful. As far as my music, it actually started with, or my composing rather, it's, although I dabbled a little previously, when I got to my first posting in Lima, Peru in 1984, and ended up filling in as a church choir director for an interdenominational English-speaking congregation that had a lot of music in its files, but not a lot of members. And so I started arranging those things, and I thought, you know, I can do some original things and slide them in. Anyway, the choir grew, that was successful, and that kept me going. And so I kind of came at it originally a lot with choral music, but since then have done chamber music and instrumental, just wrote another symphonic piece. And of course, love doing things with a soloist and a piano. Although I wish I could find more opportunities to do that, because I still, even though I've retired from the State Department, keep busy with a lot of other things.
Of course.
But for me, I think, much as I, you know, I love getting all the instruments and the orchestra and all these other things going, there's something about music and words together that can really create a whole that's greater than the sum of its parts in terms of the impact. And so that's sort of for keep going back to and doing vocal music. So
Chris, your music can be found on homademusic.com, Christopher J. Ho. And Chris, you said something a few minutes ago where you wanted to find something to keep you going and to always bring you in better contact with the people around you. And in your case, you were in many different countries. So that's a whole nother level of connecting with people and cultures. In the idea of something we need to keep us going, musical life, enriching musical life, virtual concerts for the time being, please check us out. Please continue watching this Americana music and conversation series that we're going to have on Friday evenings. And we'd like to end with Over the Rainbow in Chris's theme, Keep It Going.
Can I just jump in because I see somebody asked a question about opportunities and limitations of online performance.
Oh, good. Okay, great.
By the way, I did
we have a question on Zoom.
I put the URL for my website on the chat. I bet Josh will do that before long. But so opportunities and limitations of online performance, I find, you know, there are things that are artificial with the distance, and we're experiencing that here, but they also let you put on a concert in a way that's simpler. You don't have to rent a hall like you guys are doing. With the 13, since you mentioned that group, a locally based professional ensemble, every concert next season is going to be streamed live, so people will be able to watch it online. And there may be people who either can't get a ticket because we're going to have distance in the seating or don't feel comfortable going out, but they'll at least be able to participate that way. And I think what I find from all my musician friends is these are really challenging times.
Yeah.
And people are reinventing right and left.
Creating.
And trying to say not what can't we do, what are we up against, but what can we do? How can we connect? And I find a lot of inspiration in how people are finding ways to keep that going.
Christopher, thank you for that. You stole, you know, the answer from, this is exactly what I was going to say. I know when this first started, it was like, oh my gosh, what are we going to do? You know, how do you continue to live? How do you continue to make music? And I think that, you know, after the initial panic kind of wore off, that this, I think if anything else, it opened up opportunities and doors into things that we wouldn't have thought about. Like we probably would not have thought to do this kind of setting and have two guests in different parts of the country, right? To be able to, whether it's make an appearance or share their screen or whatever it is, and even be able to record this event so that, you know, when you have this excuse of, oh, I can't this Friday, I can't make it, and you have to miss the entire thing. Well, guess what? You can watch it later. And I think that it gives people a lot more accessibility to things that we otherwise wouldn't have really thought about creating. I think that those are the benefits. The challenge, at least for me, is not seeing the live audience and not feeling the energy of the room and almost having to create that ourselves.
Right, right. It's a different kind of creative process when it, theatrical process in a way where, you know, you can't see the audience, they're all in the dark, but now you know not only are they all in the dark, they're not even there. So physically, of course. So there's another theatrical and creative element to building that space and sharing that space with you all and those that we don't even know who they are watching. We did a version of this at the beginning of COVID, like after, not the beginning, but after a couple months, where we sang some songs and took some chats via Facebook only. And there were so many people chatting who found out about our networks and our organizations. We didn't know who they were. They were popping up requests. I ended up singing, you know, songs in Swahili. But so we said, how can we make this a bit more intimate, you know, where people know a little bit what to expect. And then they can really, like she said, share the screen, see your faces, see these live musicians, not only the performers, but everybody who is behind the scenes in a way, right?
And really find a new and unique way to connect that wasn't really on a table before.
Exactly. Thank you both so much for for making time for this evening, from your living rooms to yes. ours. Keep the spirit alive and keep thinking about what's on the other side of that rainbow, over the rainbow, by Harold Arlen.
Thank you all so much for being with us tonight, and for, you know, of course, Joshua and Christopher, and to all of you for watching, and my beautiful friend for organizing this and even having the idea to do this. We're very happy to be able to share this with all of you.
Thank you. Tonight we had Christopher J. Ho, homemademusic.com, a composer, highlighting his pieces. Also, Dr. Joshua Fishbein, fishbeinmademusic.com. I'm Solmaz Adeli, solmazadeli.com, hosted by Julie Paklewski, pianist and dear friend of and founder of Opus 11 Music. You can find both of us on Facebook and Instagram, Julie Paklewski, San Jose Piano, and Solmaz Adeli, Voice Academy Soul. We very much look forward to seeing you all again on a Friday coming up very soon. This is Americana, Music and Conversation, and we will see you over
the rainbow. Woohoo!
Thank you. Take care.